At the courthouse in Greenfield, Massachusetts, two men enter, two men leave. We'll also be discussing disturbing results from the education system in the state of Texas, as well as 15 states now considering alternative currencies. That plus a whole lot more coming up tonight on Free Minds TV.
And welcome to episode 26, season 6, or the 214th episode of Free Minds TV, where we challenge you, the viewer, to think outside the box. With you, as always, is Toby.
And Nick.
So, Nick, we've got some great news to start off the show with tonight. Yes. Yeah. We're also going to be talking about some sad news coming out of Texas, and it kind of reflects the educational system that we've been talking about on this show for years now, as well as some news about alternative currencies. I think it's appropriate to touch upon in the wake of what's going on around gold prices and the financial system
in general. And the U.S. dollar,
sure.
The fate of the U.S. economy.
But first, it's not very often that we get into some good news on the show. We try to when it comes, but more and more the encroaching government gets larger and larger and larger, and it's sometimes tough when you're going through the news to take those gems when there's so many rocks in the rough. I don't know. Anyways, on to the good news, and it has to do with the case we've been talking about on the radio show. I'm not sure if we've touched upon it on the TV show, but it started just over a year ago in July 1st to be exact, in Greenfield, Massachusetts, where the gentleman from Motorhome Diaries and Liberty on Tour, they went to Greenfield, Mass to bail out a friend from the correction facility there, and they brought their camera with them. This is Pete Ayer and Adamo Freeman. They brought a camera with them, and they videotaped the encounter of them attempting to bail out their friend. They were subsequently arrested and charged with a few charges, I think eight between the two of them, a couple of felonies, some misdemeanors in there, and a year later it finally went to trial. This is after numerous times where the state tried to plea bargain them out. As we've talked about before, plea bargains account for 90 plus percent of cases that don't go to trial because they're pled out. They offered them numerous plea bargains. The latest I heard was for the numerous felonies they were charged with, facing years in jail if they were found guilty by the jury. Last chance was something like a $300 fine and an agreement not to sue the Greenfield police. But they refused the plea bargain. They said, don't take the plea. They took it to the jury trial, and they were victorious, facing all these felony charges. Some of them were dismissed before the trial began, but the biggest one, wiretapping for videotaping the police, the jury found both of them not guilty, including not guilty of resisting arrest charges as well. So great news, and it says good things about the jury. I know I've badmouthed juries a lot here, but all you need is one good one, and I guess that's what came through. That, according to some of the post interviews with the jurors, there were some of them wanted to convict, but it just took one guy convincing them not.
It actually started out the deliberations on the filming charges. I recall them saying it was actually at one point 4-2 against the defendant, so it was 4 going for a guilty verdict and 2 going for a not guilty verdict before the jury talked about it a little bit more. So it wasn't by all that much, Toby, that they actually avoided felony prison time. So, I mean, they did take a big risk here.
Yep.
And, you know, when you consider that they were being offered a deal for a $300 fine.
And that's it.
And no, that tells you, when they bargain multiple felony counts.
They're facing many years in jail.
Right. But when the state's prepared to offer a deal where they, you know, you can pay a $300 fine for multiple felony counts.
And an agreement not to sue them, of course.
And the agreement not to sue them is telling, too. It shows you that they don't have a very strong case. But, you know, a guilty verdict's a guilty verdict. So whether you take it as a plea deal or you take it to trial and, you know, you're convicted, it might affect the sentence. But, you know, a felony is a felony, and it doesn't look too good on your record. So there's something to be said for simply fighting it.
And I think there's also a lot to be said while Adamo and Pete were in Greenfield. While they were there they've been there many times over the past year, they really got the public involved in there through their website, copblock.org, as well as the Motorhome Diaries and Liberty on Tour. They went out there and they've been flyering, they've been talking to the locals, and I mean, this trial did way more than just show people that, some juries aren't willing to put people behind bars for videotaping the police in a public place. It just put liberty on the map in Greenfield, somewhere where it wasn't before. And so I know that right before we talked about on Sunday's radio show, the day before the trial began, we talked about how they both were very happy already just because they called it a win for all the activism and all the literature they got out to people, and such as don't take the plea deal and no victim, no crime, all that stuff when they were there. They were very happy already. So this was just an even bigger win for both of them. And after facing years in jail, this has got to be a lot of relief for the both of them. So, notch one up for liberty and jury trials, too.
Well, yeah, I guess in Greenfield, Mass., it seems like the court system is functioning, you know, in this particular case anyway. A good thing happened as far as people advancing people's freedom. We're not quite as lucky here in New Hampshire, which is supposed to be freer than Massachusetts by most people's logic. I mean, we're still having a number of problems, especially here in Keene, with the local circuit, you know, the district court. So we'll see how that continues to play out. Because sure. Ademo, I think on the TV show, we've only focused on the issues that have been taking place recently in Keene. You know, I don't want to say it's a similar case because the charges that were leveled were much different, but he was threatened with a felony count and initially charged with a felony count of threatening a judge or improperly influencing a judge for filming a judge here in Keene. So, I mean, effectively, that's what his crime was. He asked a couple of questions and he rolled a camera. So we're still, the charges were dropped, but we're still running into those issues here in New Hampshire. So, I mean, you win some, and I'm glad that they won in this case. You also don't win every day.
And true.
Certainly not all the battles have been won.
Yeah, and there have been a couple of jury trials here in Keene where the results weren't as good. But I think one key piece is Ademo and Pete were very prepared for this case. They also had tons of activism support.
Be prepared
more than any other case,
going to prison for years.
They had over 50 people there the first day in the courtroom, applauding, laughing at the prosecution sometimes. That kind of won over the jury. They had over 30 people the next day while they were finishing up the closing remarks and stuff. There was a lot of support with this inside the courtroom from activists coming in and from the locals, from what I hear. So this was unprecedented, the number of supporters that were here. And this could only happen, this wasn't in New Hampshire, but right over the border in Massachusetts, so the New Hampshire activists went over as well. You can only get support like this, I think, here or around New Hampshire, somewhere similar where there's other like-minded people who agree with the principles of liberty, freedom, the non-aggressive principle, the no victim,
well,
no
yeah,
crime
being
principle.
Able to send, you know, a couple dozens of full-time activists across the state line into Massachusetts certainly helped, because I don't think there would have been, you know, I don't think Pete and Ademo on their own would have been able to reach out to the activists in Greenfield.
No.
You know, two guys, they would not have been able to do the outreach that really required 20 or 30 people.
Especially while they were focusing on defending themselves and staying out of prison for the next, I think, 6 years for the wiretapping charge, as well as all the other charges that were also dismissed or they were found not guilty on. So great news from there. So they can focus on just education rather than defending themselves. But this is a show all around the country, all around the world. So let's talk about other places. Let's go down to Texas to give us a foothold for talking about the education system.
Yeah, well, apparently there's some not so great news coming out of Texas. There, the Council of State Government did a study on all seventh graders, which was nearly 1 million students, and it followed them through their secondary education, so through high school. It found that fully 60% were expelled, suspended, or given in-school suspensions before the end of, whether they dropped out or graduated, before the end of their high school career, which strikes me as a pretty high number, Toby. I know there are a lot of relatively ill-behaved students in some public school systems, and certainly some states, some municipalities, you know, they have a different base of students that they're working with to begin with. But for it to be statewide and for it to be over half, 6 out of 10 students are getting these relatively serious disciplinary actions taken against them, it makes me question, sure, there are plenty of ill-behaved kids out there, and I actually, personally, having gone through the public schools, I think what the public schools are lacking, and perhaps what they're incapable of providing, is a structured enough learning environment. When I went to high school, well, towards the end, the story changed a little bit. But for the most part, I wanted to learn things. And I got pretty bored because, and stopped paying attention, really, because there wasn't a whole lot of learning going on. Like, half of the classes, and some of these were honors classes. I wasn't in the foundations level, the basic level classes. Half of the class time was spent with teachers correcting students, or students just wasting class time.
Sure.
Maybe not quite half, but I would be willing to bet, in terms of hard numbers, I would say a hard one-third of school time is just wasted dealing with bad behavior.
Well, I think there's so many different factors here, Nick, to look at that it's difficult to just pick on one. I mean, let's take I know public schools are often a reflection on society itself, but as you said, when you have kids in schools, and as we've talked about before and most people are aware now, the dropout rate has been pushed up. So you have a lot of kids that in previous years would not be attending school, so they're bored in school. So a lot of the time, they just create trouble and take away from other people's learning experiences. Now, this could easily be changed if schools were willing to evolve, change, but the public school system is kind of on this one-track system and doesn't really want to accommodate students who don't want to just sit in a classroom. So many students out there don't need traditional school, but what they could use is some kind of learning opportunity to take additional shop classes or maybe go out into the world and apprentice somewhere. Or it doesn't need to be in a classroom, but because, you know, well, we have to have the test scores and we have to have everybody sitting in a seat. I mean, schools are refusing to evolve and they're increasingly having to take on students who are much more difficult to put in those seats. You have people who don't even speak English in English-speaking classrooms. It makes it
difficult. Well, you
also
have people with no desire to learn sitting in classrooms. I mean, I know here in New Hampshire, it used to be, you know, when I was in high school, you could drop out at the age of 16 with parental consent. I wouldn't say that's a good idea.
No.
But let's consider the fact that a significant proportion of the kids did that. I'm not sure exactly how many chose to drop out before graduation, but I can remember when, you know, you typically didn't graduate maybe 25% of your class. How many of those dropped out and how many flunked out, I don't know. But a lot of them were dropouts. And now you've got this 10, 15, 20%, whatever it is, of the student population. They have no desire to learn for a couple of years, but they're required to be in school. And I remember teachers, public school teachers, complaining about this because they don't want to have to babysit any more than they already do. I mean, I understand that teaching young children, teaching junior high kids, you know, 12, 13, 14-year-old kids, that's one thing. But by the time somebody is 15, 16, 17, 18 years old, you know, if they're not on track with their education, odds are they're not going to get back on track. And if they're just not interested in learning, at least in a school setting, book learning, then why try to force them to? You're wasting their time. You're wasting the school district's time, the taxpayers' resources, trying to teach somebody who's just, you know, just going to throw it away, basically. And you're, most importantly, I think you're wasting the time of all the students who are going there to learn. Yeah. I thought it was a place of learning, not a freaking daycare center.
Well, I think the key piece there, Nick, that we need to focus in on is the kind of learning the kids are getting and the kind of learning that the schools can't offer because it's a bureaucracy, because it's a government bureaucracy, and their funding mandates and everything else are based on regular traditional student learning and sitting in a desk, book learning, taking a test afterwards. If schools wanted to wake up to the new society and what the new demands on society, they really need to restructure the way a lot of students learn. Not everybody is going to be on track for college, and it's foolish to treat everybody like they are. Many students will be just fine if you give them some education towards regular blue-collar work. There's nothing wrong with that. And the schools refuse to evolve because their educational model, their funding model, their testing model, the way they get licensed by the state and the way they get those federal dollars, they're just not set up that way, and change is extremely hard because, well, they're government schools.
I think part of the problem was when government got involved in the picture when it came to education, what they were doing was, prior to public education, you know, places of learning had a pretty long tradition that they drew on. I mean, if you look at most universities today, there's a lot of Latin terminology. There's a lot of ideas about the way learning is supposed to work that go back to, you know, antiquity, back to ancient academies and universities. But you have to remember, you're basing that model off a thousands-year-old picture of places of learning when higher learning really wasn't that common, and when everybody pretty much going to these universities, you know, hundreds and thousands of years ago, well, the few people who managed to go to university were smart, most likely, and they were inclined to do it. They were places where people were actively participating in the learning process. When you have a public school system like we have today that tries to apply that model to everybody when they're 15 and 16 years old, it falls apart pretty quickly, because 15 and 16 year olds, even some of the ones who they're not necessarily completely opposed to learning, and it's not their purpose to be, you know, to put up obstacles to the learning of others and things like that. They're not trying to be a pain in the butt. They've just got other priorities, or they're just not people who learn in the way that you're trying to teach them. So I think that we've just got a model that's been created and largely reinforced by government at this point, where public education, you're trying to deliver a thousands-year-old education model to 15-year-old kids in the modern era, and it just does not make a whole lot of sense.
Well, it did for a long time.
It did. No, there's a reason these traditions exist.
From, say, 1900 until 1960, 1970, it made a lot of sense. You were preparing people to work in factories,
just get an 8th or 9th grade education, and then if you were
going to
drive
in a factory,
a truck, or work on a farm, that would be enough.
It's a different society. I'm not claiming to know how to fix education, but I know that there's a lot of smart people out there that have some very good ideas about this. Mr. Gatto, he's an excellent scholar on education. I think that we need to start looking at some people who are talking about alternative styles, maybe even looking at what some other countries are doing, because our education system is severely broken. The funding model is broken. The incentives are broken. I don't think that this is a fault of teachers. I'm a huge supporter of teachers, but they're starting with a flawed product to begin with. The schools that they're working on need a serious overhaul. Unfortunately, the way that they're set up, it just doesn't look like it's happening. We're going in the wrong direction, not the right direction. I want to make this perfectly clear. I believe education is extremely important. I believe that living in a free society, or as free of a society as possible, can't be done if you don't have an educated populace. But I think there are much better ways to educate that populace than we are currently doing right now. And the road that we're taking, it's kind of scary on what the next generation will look like, because they're not getting a good education.
No.
At least many of them.
I think the schools are getting worse, and I mean,
the incentives are all wrong. It's a bureaucracy that's slow to change.
Right. I mean, I used to say that in this area where we're broadcasting from New Hampshire, in our particular area, you know, I would say that the Keene schools and things like that are pretty good, but I don't think they, regardless of what test scores and things like that say, I don't think the quality
test
of education.
Test scores mean nothing, though.
Yeah, I mean, just teaching people how to behave like couth human beings, it doesn't.
That's another issue, Nick, because education has become so prevalent and it's such a government job, you lose out on a lot of the parenting factor. A lot of what goes on, you wouldn't need the schools to be doing all this stuff if they left parenting to the parents. But in this where the government will take care of your children from cradle to grave type mentality, you're going to lose out on the fundamental piece of a child's education and social upbringing, and how about just morality, decency, ethics. You're going to lose out on all of that when you're counting on the government to do it. And I think that when the public schools say, we'll take care of your job, we'll socialize your child with everything, yes, I believe some of that is important, and you know, children growing up with peers and getting socialized that way. But when you're counting on the government to do all of it, well, you're in some serious trouble. You're losing out on a lot, and you're getting a lot of behavioral problems that schools just, well, let's face it, aren't set up to deal with, because they're not parents. They're supposed to be places where people can learn. I don't have all the answers, Nick. I just know it's severely messed up, and we should turn to some people who maybe do have the answers. Look at some of the research, because that's not going on right now.
I wish more people in the education community would do that. I know it's a difficult position to take, but it's clear that the educational system is not working. And quite often how this debate gets framed, especially in the mainstream debate, is you have a debate where one side says, the system is fine, it's except for the fact that it's just underfunded, which is incorrect. And then you have another side that says, well, basically, teachers and schools suck. I mean, the argument gets sharpened to that point where they're not just saying the system of education that we have right now is not working. Then they have to say, well, just schools don't work and teachers don't work.
As someone who works in the school, it's very difficult to even talk about this. I'm not supposed to talk about this kind of stuff. You're supposed to be, like you said, Nick, pick a side. You're either for the teachers or you're against the teachers. You're for the schools or against the schools. They're just underfunded is the issue. No, it's the teachers that suck is the issue. No, that's not true. And unfortunately, a lot of the people who are in education who do have some ideas to fix it aren't allowed to talk about it because then they'll be ridiculed by their colleagues or they'll be looked down upon or when it comes to get a job. My wife just asked me, I'm going to be finishing up grad school next year. She's like, well, how are you going to get a job after this in education? Are you at all worried about that? Well, a little bit, but I'm also worried if educators don't start talking about this. It's very worrisome if they just put their heads in the sand and go, well, I can't talk about how the system's broken because how is that going to make my job? The system is broken. We need to start fixing it. We need to look at the people who have the
ideas. That's a very good point, but that's not unique. I mean, those kinds of issues where people working within the system but acknowledge that there are problems with the system being unwilling to come forward, that's not unique to the educational system. I think it happens a lot, particularly when you're talking about either government jobs or jobs that are pretty much set up by the government, police work. There are a lot of police officers who, in their off time, might have criticisms about the way that the criminal justice system is set up. It's very difficult for them to actually voice those concerns, even in a professional, civilized way that doesn't impact their job. They're going to get ridiculed. They're going to have to worry about getting passed over for promotions and things like that. So it's not just education. I think any of these areas where government touches on our lives, a lot of the people working inside the system acknowledge that it's far from perfect, whether you're talking about the criminal justice system or the educational system or the military. You name a program, people actually
many necessary programs,
right,
too.
Right. People, or at least necessary services, whether they need to be government programs.
Right, exactly. But necessary, teachers are necessary. Policemen are necessary. Firefighters are necessary.
Yeah, we need people to put out fires and, catch scabby people and educate children. These are all important things. But I don't feel like there is any kind of unanimity among people who work in the police force or the fire department or in education. There might be a majority viewpoint that's supportive of the current system or not. I guess it all depends on where you
work. Pay lip service to it, at least.
Right, but I don't believe there's nearly as much of a unified front on that as people are led to believe as actually exists. I mean, what people are willing to say in public is far different than how they actually feel about these services. And I wish that more people, regardless of whether you work for, whatever agency it is you work for, if you're working in state government, we're very harshly critical of state government. In fact, quite often we're very harshly critical of people who work for government agencies.
Most of the time.
But our ultimate aim here is not to call people names, it's to try to come up with a better model for the way we interact and the way society is ordered.
Sure.
And that's not going to happen unless those of you working on the inside are willing to at least talk to your colleagues about these issues.
Get thinking.
You don't have to come to a TV show, but you can talk to people about this.
I hear just last week someone said to me, watching your show is very difficult because I agree with so much you say, but I would never say any of that stuff myself. And I think that's a way a lot of people operate. Is because you know one thing you're supposed to say, and then there's the reality of the situation.
There's a reason that exists, because if somebody asks you if they look fat, in social interaction, there's a reason human beings are programmed that way.
I don't think white lies are a good thing when they go into your
public policy. Well, when they go into using the force of government and do we go to war? Yeah, I don't think it's a good idea.
It's a socially acceptable thing to say is wave the flag and say go troops.
I don't think it's a good idea, but I'm not going to be critical at this moment because I don't want to look unpatriotic.
I don't want to think I'm against schools and teachers by criticizing public education. Well, let's be honest, there's something wrong. Well, Nick, we did plug it and we're running out of time to get to it, but another system that is seriously flawed, more so, I would argue, than public education, is something most of you have in your back pocket, and unfortunately, it's dwindling, or at least the value of it is dwindling. Maybe there's more and more in circulation, but they're worth less and less. And that's your greenbacks, your Federal Reserve notes, all your money. Well, it's just worth less every single day because, well, you got debts to pay, and when the money's not coming in, it's easier to print the money than it is to downsize some of your big government programs. And this is making a lot of state governments think, well, maybe we should come up with our own currency. 15 of them have done so far, have put out legislation suggesting the idea or are playing with the idea right now. There's a number of them, including Washington, Idaho, Montana, Colorado, Oklahoma, Indiana, Tennessee. They go on. New Hampshire's on there. I like to hear that. But I can see why they're wanting to do this, because the dollar, according to this article, which I'll post up on our show notes, it's from foxnews.com, so I don't know how accurate their reporting is here, but they're quoting that the dollar has lost 40% of its value since 2001. That's a lot. I don't know if I believe it's that high, but I know
high. I would absolutely believe that if you include things like gas.
Sure.
And remember,
purchasing power has definitely lost that much a couple years ago? But you don't know if that's inflation or if that's supply and demand or if that's speculation. It's difficult to say how much value
all of the purchasing food, power, supply and demand.
Well, you can definitely say your purchasing power has gone down 40%.
I don't know if it's all monetary-based inflation. That's correct. But I think the thing that is going to make this a real issue to people is if we do either hit a default come August 2nd, or we come close to hitting a default. Gold already, as we're
recording
this,
record highs again this week.
Over $1,600 an ounce. I would not be surprised to see the dollar tank, bond rates spike, and the value of gold shoot through the roof. I'm not giving you investment advice. I'm just saying that any kind of worries about a default are just going to give you a little bit of a preview of what's coming when this monetary system fails. I don't think we're there yet, but you're going to get a little bit of a taste of it. And maybe, hopefully, that'll make some of you realize just how important this issue is.
Yeah. You know, the one of the constitutional scholars that they talk to says, the Constitution flatly prohibits states from issuing their own currency. Mr. Eric Freeman, who's the Hofstra Law School in New York professor guy. Whatever in the form of coins or in the form of paper money, it's unconstitutional. Well, yeah, guess what? The federal government has broken its contract with the 50 states numerous times, more than you can possibly count on all the fingers in the state of New Hampshire, probably. So why are we upholding this one? I say that this is great news because it gets people thinking and talking about what real money is. Guess what these states are proposing? They're proposing having a currency that's backed by something, whether that's gold or silver or some other commodity. Guess what your money's backed by? $14+ trillion of debt.
I don't buy the constitutional arguments one bit. It is flatly unconstitutional. It's flatly unconstitutional for the states to issue currency.
It's also unconstitutional.
It's unconstitutional for the Congress to emit bills of credit and to not actually regulate the value
and
of the money.
And have it backed by something.
And if it needs to be an unconstitutional policy, it should at least be one that protects
the contract's been broken, Nick. The contract between the states has been broken. But that's going to do it for us. We're out of time this week. Join us next week, freemindsmedia.org, freemindstv.com. However you want to get to us, we'll be fine. Have a good week.